Today I'm going to be talking about shifting cultural lenses in psychological interventions, with a particular emphasis on training, how we go about training folks to address cultural and sociocultural issues. This might help. The overall goal is to describe a process-oriented approach to cultural training of mental health professionals and present some preliminary data of the evaluation of our training. My colleagues and I have carried out hundreds of cultural competence training in Southern California, and we advocate for a shifting cultural lenses model. One of the things that we do when we carry out this training is we try to evaluate whether or not the training has an impact. And one of the questions that we ask of the clinicians and counselors and therapists is, how do they define culture? And here are three examples. These are all Latinx therapists in Southern California, and I'll be using fictitious names. Sal, a marriage and family therapist, referred to culture as language use, ethnic food, time spent in the country of origin, and emotional and affective ties to the group of origin. And to illustrate, he pointed out the difference in which which Mexicans deal with death compared to Irish. Mariana, also a marriage and family therapist, defined culture as rituals, food, language, music, and religion of a specific group. And for her, family is particularly important for the Mexican culture. Mariana identifies as Mexicana. And Susana, a social worker, refers to individual values, how people identify themselves and how they fit in the world. And as an illustration, she pointed out that for the Hispanic culture, she says, conversation is really important. So although each of the definitions vary in terms of the particulars, one of the key characteristics that's shared by all three of them is a group-based notion of culture. And this is consistent with a review of the cultural competency training research. Lorraine Benuto pointed out that most trainings focus on increasing knowledge of different groups. The advantage of this approach, the advantage is that it points out to folks that mainstream models may not apply to diverse groups. That's an important point to communicate. But the risk is that we're promoting group-based notions that can lead to cultural stereotypes. We did a study, actually the very first published journal article, in 1986, some of you may not have even been born in 1986, and we did a male survey of psychologists, psychiatrists, and social workers, and asked them to asked whether or not they considered culture, whether they thought it was important, but more importantly, we asked them to describe a particular case and where they considered culture and how it may have impacted their judgment or their treatment. Most of the therapists said culture was important and they use it regularly with their culturally diverse folks. But I want to share with you one particular vignette, one report. This was a therapist who reported that she was seeing a Hispanic woman, these are her words, the therapist's words. She was seeing a Hispanic woman who she was concerned that had low ego strength or a poor self-image. But then she thought, she noted that the wife was in a relationship with a husband who was having extramarital relations. But then she thought, this is culturally normative for the Hispanic culture. It's accepted for Hispanic women that their men have extramarital affairs. Tell that to my wife. So how do we teach therapists about culture in a way that does not promote stereotypes? Group notions are really important, but equally important is how we go about considering culture. We need process approaches as well as group-based approaches, content approaches. Let me tell you a little bit of the background to this process approach that I'll be sharing with you today. I was very blessed and fortunate to have Bernie Weiner as my mentor. I was at UCLA in the late 70s and the early 80s, and Bernie Weiner is an attributional theorist. And this idea of considering culture is an attributional problem. If you attribute your client's behavior to culture, does it alter your judgment and your treatment? Take into account that case I pointed out. Might that therapist miss a problematic marriage and miss not giving her the proper treatment or the couple the proper treatment that it needed because it's supposedly culturally normative? In our early work, we published some research in terms of psychotherapy and also in terms of assessment and how to consider cultural issues from a process-oriented point of view. In addition to the attributional perspective, I've been influenced by anthropological research. Arthur Kleinman has a really important paper in the early 90s in which he raised the question of the interpretive dilemma. Arthur Kleinman is both a psychiatrist and an anthropologist. And the interpretive dilemma is the following. He essentially asked anthropologists, that was the audience for his article, but it applies to us as psychologists and therapists as well. He asked the question, how can we be sure that our professional transformations respect and capture the essence of our clients' experiences, as opposed to reducing them to theoretical cartoons or caricatures that misrepresent their rich and dynamic lives? Now, when we talk about professional transformations, Kleinman refers to emotions, cognitions, dialectics, family systems, intrapsychic conflicts. These are some of our conceptual tools in our transformations. How can we be sure that we're not imposing our notions on folks and then forgetting thin understanding of their experience? And he makes two important points in terms of how we can avoid imposing our notions. One is the basic idea of what is experience? Kleinman argues that experience is the nexus, that theoretical space between the social world, the mind, and the body. As a psychologist, I always thought experience was largely within our body and in our mind. But he's saying it's sure really important to consider it's anchored in the social world. And so to operationalize this, he says what experience is, to really get a handle on it, is what is vitally important to people in their local worlds, in their daily lives. Peter Guarnaccia, another anthropologist, and I wrote a paper where we adapted his Kleinman's notion of experience to use as our definition of culture. So instead of culture being the values, beliefs, and practices of specific groups defined by race or nationality or ethnicity, we argue that culture is what's at stake in people's local social worlds. And it's a grounded approach to culture, not necessarily the typical approach. Another point that he made in this important paper is that therapists and ethnographers should shift their lenses. They should understand the client from the point of view of the client and understand their, quote, near experience. But they should also step back and apply their own lens. And so it's not about replacing a mainstream norm or model with a multicultural norm. No, it's about being able to shift between both sets of norms on an ongoing basis over time to shed light on the experience of the individual. So the shifting lenses is a core concept of our model. The third aspect that I want to add to this anthropological contribution is the notion of a shared narrative. Another anthropologist, Cheryl Mattingly, and her colleague Mary Lalor, studied African-American families dealing with the health of their youth, of their children. And one of the things that they observed in their studies is that the successful medical encounters were ones in which both the health practitioner and the families developed a shared understanding of the illness condition, a shared understanding of what the treatment was needed to address that illness. And so it's coming together in a co-constructed narrative, a shared narrative, that led to the successful medical encounter. I think that's really important as well in our work as therapists. And it gives a voice, an even stronger voice, to our clients. So those are the three cultural tenets. But one of the limitations of the approach so far, attributional, culture is what's at stake in people's local social world, shifting lenses, a shared narrative, is how do you see it in our work as therapists? How do you see it in the students that we supervise and train? What are the behavioral indicators? I'm a big fan of cultural humility because of the openness and the idea of curiosity. Celia Falikov talks about curiosity. But what are the behaviors that we need to see that represent cultural humility? A lot of the research is on self-reported cultural humility or clients' cultural humility. How about the behaviors? So my colleagues and I came up with a set of behaviors that we think capture this notion of shifting cultural lenses. It came out recently in Transcultural Psychiatry, and here's a quick summary. Essentially, we're arguing the shifting cultural lenses. How well does the clinician, the counselor, access the client's view? Secondly, how well does a clinician counselor integrate the client's view? So if they call something nerves or nervios, do you use that term or do you continue to use anxiety or depression, for example? And then on the therapist side, how well do we express our views as I statements? I'm wondering if, or my point of view is this, so that we're pointing out we're willing to negotiate as opposed to imposing. It's clear that you know you have some negative cognitions with regard to your depression. Instead of, I'm wondering if. And then, how well do we use buy-in? Is it possible that that's the case? And bringing together these four behavioral indicators reflect on what we think is working and negotiating towards a shared narrative. To give you an example, well, the other thing, before going to the example, is that these behavioral indicators, we believe, occur across the domain of clinical and counseling practice. Not only is it at the helper model and the clinical and the presenting problem, how the client defines it, but it also should be, we should be accessing our clients' models. How are they dealing with these stressors? What has been useful in the past? What has it? And their conceptualizations as well. And so the methods and their conceptualizations are critically important. So accessing the client's view, presenting the therapist's view, integrating the client's view, getting buy-in and negotiating that shared narrative should cut across all aspects of our work. Here's to give you a little bit of an example based on some of our research. One particular client, a 35-year-old woman, Mexican-American mother, suffered from panic attacks as well as depression. The therapist identifies Euro-American man and a narrative therapist. And the client at this point, it's a first session, is talking about how, when she's sad, how she and her children interact. Client begins. And then telling me, why are you crying now? Why are you crying now? I try to make it a 5-minute thing, but sometimes I'm cleaning and cooking or have the radio on. Tears just fall. Yeah, says the therapist. And so they see those tears and they might ask about them. Yes. And you'd like them not to see the tears falling? Now, are they still seeing you cook while the tears are falling? Yeah. Wow. What do you think they're learning about you in that? Accessing the client's view. Negative. Negative, really? What would they be learning about you that's negative in that? Accessing the client's view. Integrating the client's perspective, using the term negative. Well, because I'm doing everyday chores, I'm doing my cleaning, cooking, laundry. Yes, I'm hearing that. And I'm picking up my children, taking them to and from school, yeah. And I don't want them to think that I'm not happy about doing it. Oh, okay, I see. You see, I had a little bit different perspective on that, but I can see what you're saying, yeah. You want your kids to have a sense that you enjoy the life that you're making for them. Integrating the client's view. Yes. Okay. What I thought your kids might be getting from that is that mom's pretty courageous and she's very determined. And even if she's feeling things strongly, she keeps doing what we need in order to keep our home together and our life together. Presenting the therapist's view, what I thought your kids might be getting. Yeah. Is that possible for them to see it that way? Trying to get buy-in. Yes, I never sat down to talk to them about it, but I hope that's what they're thinking. But in their little minds, I don't know what they're really thinking. Right. Okay, so this represents then conceptual underpinnings and the behavioral indicators. then we're in a position now to see if we can implicate this training. And we carried out training in multiple counties in Southern California with individual therapists. And the heart of the training was a 7-hour workshop. We recruited over 900 individuals at this 7-hour workshop. And in assessing it, we looked at their satisfaction with different characteristics of the workshop. And we also assessed the knowledge of the shifting cultural lenses model both before and after the workshop. But we also, to get a sense of the behavioral indicators, we also carried out a pre-training assessment with a small number of these clinicians. It's hard to get folks to agree to this, but we recorded the first two sessions with a Latinx client, and we did transcriptions and we did the behavioral indicator coding. We also carried out an interview after each of these first two sessions. We used that then following the workshop for a 2-hour individualized training where we drew on the transcription, drew on the coding of the behavioral indicators, and reported back to the clinician and said, these are the strengths and these are areas that you need to work on. And then after that training, we did a post-training assessment where a client, where a therapist saw a new Latinx client, and we did the same recording, behavioral coding, and the interview following each session. So I'm going to run through rather quickly some of the key findings. First of all, here's a little bit of background to the participants. Again, keep in mind, these are community-based clinics and practitioners. So they're mostly marriage and family therapists and social workers. Most of them are women, and a little over a third are Latinx therapists, about a third Euro-American, and then almost a third from other different groups. Here's the first finding, has to do with the workshop. Overall, the workshop was well received. If you look at each specific domain that was assessed, you can see that the participants saw it as either excellent or good, nearly over 90% of either excellent or good. The second thing that we found is that we saw a shift in the knowledge from pre-training about shifting cultural lenses to after the workshop. The third point is that we were able to assess with the 20 clinicians their behavioral indicators. And what we see is not a lot of representation of these behavioral indicators. Our coders rated the extent to which each of these behavioral indicators fell on a 0 to 4 scale. 0 meaning it's not there, not there, 2, 4 meaning it's very present. And you can see that in accessing the client's view and presenting the therapist's views on the 2 range, so some of that was present, but is even less so on integrating the client's view, obtaining the client's buy-in, and negotiating a shared narrative. Now, we only had 9 of the clinicians who actually were able to carry out this in-depth assessment, both pre and post, and we saw no change in the behavioral indicators, which is something that we're looking for. But we did see a beginning shift in their construals of culture. Remember those 3 therapists that I talked to you about at the beginning? They all shared this group-based notion of culture. Well, Sal continued to have that, even after the training. Mariana began incorporating what's important in people's daily lives, as well as the values and other aspects. But Susana really bought our model of what culture is. She put aside Latinx cultural notions and said, for example, even the umbrella of being Latin is so vague, there could be Latinos from Mexico, Argentina, Venezuela, and with completely different experiences. So we saw some variability in the shift. All right. In wrapping this up, I want to leave you with 2 questions, or 2 sets of questions. The first is, in your settings, in your clinics, your counseling settings, in your schools, how is culture defined and considered? Are group-based notions of culture being applied that risk stereotypes? Or are socially grounded concepts of culture of the individual the ones being implicated? And then the second question is, how well do you and your colleagues shift your lenses and develop shared narratives across the treatment domains? Or to what extent are you imposing more your models and not working closely to develop shared narratives. So what I presented today is a foundation that we're laying, both conceptual and behavioral, for a process model of cultural training, one that is attributional in nature, that grounds culture in the local social world of individual clients, that guides therapists to shift lenses as well as develop shared narratives, and has clear behavioral anchors and can be systematically evaluated. These initial steps, we believe, show promise in advancing a process model that can help us as therapists learn about the social cultural worlds of our clients in a way that respects their rich and dynamic lives. Thank you very much.